Hi everyone, so I went to Jordan last week with John and with UNHCR, the UN Refugee Agency, and I spent most of my time in Zaatari and Azraq camps and also in the homes of Syrian refugees who are settled in Amman in the city itself. I spent my time filming, walking around, listening to the stories of the Syrians who welcomed us into their homes and told us about their deepest losses and deepest ambitions. I met a lot of Syrian girls in these conversations, but also as we wandered around the camp and spoke to people, and every single girl I met wanted to go to school, wanted to be in school, wanted to be educated. There were several reasons why they were out of school, might be pulled out of school, had been out of school, and in this, the first of several videos about stories from Syrians, I want to give you an overview of some of the girls we met, their education status, and why it matters. So in Azraq camp, we met Aida and Majida, who just arrived at the camp the previous night. They'd been there for maybe 12 hours when we met them. Immediately prior to that, they'd been waiting at the border in Syria for 4 months and 10 days in extreme weather. In weather that went at like -10°C, freezing cold weather. They had a tent, they would walk 10 kilometers a day for wood and for water, and would often get there and there wouldn't be any. And by the way, there are tens of thousands of Syrians waiting at the border and the conditions are desperate. Aida, I believe, had never been to school. Majida had been out of school for 5 years because it was just too dangerous to go in Syria. They'd actually been in Jordan before. They came as refugees, and like so many of the people we met, they just wanted to go home to Syria. So they did, and their sister was killed. They were so excited to go to school and to have a safe, warm night in the camp. There was this tiger group of women mentoring girls. The girls were all 12 years old. Their names, and I apologize, my pronunciation is terrible, were Ariam, Farah, and Doha. They all loved going to school. They thought it was very important, much to the delight of their mentors, Manar and Noah. But they're only able to go half days, as funding for refugees is so low that they do not have the resources that they need to provide full day education at scale. Every single staff member I met from the UNHCR and its partners that it works with wanted to give everyone a better education, but frankly they need the money and they don't have the money. Having done some reading about child marriage before we came, we asked the girls whether they felt pressured into marrying young, and this is something that can happen. It might be hard to understand, but it's seen as a protective move from the family. There is a sense of, once you marry a girl off, you're protecting her by putting her in the care of her husband, and that is also one fewer mouth to feed. This can come with a whole ream of problems, especially if it's a big age difference, if the girl is pulled out of school, and many other situations. In a moment that genuinely made me smile from ear to ear, the girls all said, "We worry that our parents will ask us to marry early, but we are ready to tell them no." These girls have lioness ambition. They want to become doctors, engineers. Their favorite subjects are maths, English, and Arabic. And like so many of the people we met in the camp, they love to play football. When we asked their mentors about their worries though, they said that looking at their dreams and ambitions, they just don't think that they're possible unless a miracle takes place. And that's a lot to do with the standard of education. A family we met in Zaatari camp included the daughters Asia and Fatma. Asia was 18, she's the first in her entire family to go to university, and we actually spoke to her the day before her first day of university. She said, "I'm not nervous." I think I'm right to say that she was one of the first 13 refugees from the camp to be accepted to a Jordanian university. And preparing for university, guessing the grades, all of that is hard enough outside of a refugee camp, let alone when your classes have 75 students, are 30 minutes per subject, your whole school day is half a day, you sometimes don't have electricity so you can study at night. The camp currently has enough resources for only 11 hours of electricity, so you see the electricity come on and off. And this might seem trivial in comparison to some of the other things I mentioned, but I think it is really important. The Jordanian education system is different from the Syrian education system, so it's something that takes getting used to, and in some cases some people choose to teach classes to themselves following the Syrian education system, but again, there's just not the resources across the board there for education. We asked the girls whether they thought there were any challenges particular to being a girl in a refugee camp, and they said that one of them were their parents' worries. You can't just leave home whenever you want, you can't wander around the camp, it's a camp of 80,000 people. And Asia said that there are many families that stop their children from going to school just because they don't like them walking around the refugee camp. Asia's sister Fatma was 16 years old and she wants to go to university to become an English teacher. But whenever we met with Syrians, we asked them if they had any memories from Syria, what their memories were from Syria, and she talked about her best friend who is still there, and she doesn't know if she's okay and she's only spoken to her on the phone once. We spoke to a family in a woman-led household, and when we asked the mother why she left Syria, she said, "There was a trend going around in our village that they slaughtered the children and raped the girls. I reached a point that I had to seek safety somewhere else. There were military checkpoints everywhere, and for my daughter to go to school, she had to cross 14 checkpoints, and who knows what would have happened during those checks." She said, "I couldn't risk it, and I feared for my children's lives." Because her older son is of military recruitment age, he can't actually cross the border, so he and his father, her husband, have decided to stay in Syria, and she went ahead with the children. Her daughter Samaya, who is 17, told us about her education. She said she came to Jordan, and when she enrolled, she was told that she would have to enroll in a much younger class. This is partly because of the checkpoint situation. She had to drop out of school in Syria, and so now she's very behind. She added that she knows that being a single female head of household is very difficult, so she wanted to support her mother, especially as now that her brother is in Syria, she's the oldest child in the family. Samaya is looking at education courses that allow her to follow the Syrian education system. We asked Samaya, who didn't want her face to be filmed, whether she worried about early marriage, and she said no, because we've actually never talked about it. To that, her mother said, "We have been fighting for freedom of expression and freedom of opinion in Syria for 5 years, and I cannot impose early marriage on her while we are away." Her brother, who is 13 years old, is not in school. He's joining an educational enhancement program with the Norwegian Refugee Council, but it's not like a full school program. He helps her sister around the house, and Samaya confirmed that. She said, "He drives me nuts, but he helps." In Nazareth camp, there was a teacher called Nahid who was just 25 years old, so 1 year older than me, and she spoke passionately about education. She volunteers in the camp as a teacher, leading classes of sometimes 50 students, and she talked about child marriage, about how sometimes in her job she sees 14-year-old girls with children. Her day-to-day life involves a great deal more manual labor than it did in Syria, and even though there is a lot of parity in her relationship, her husband helps out a lot, she still doesn't have time to help the children with things like their homework, and you can tell that she just can't stand it. While she was talking about this, her 7-year-old daughter Hayam rushed over to me with her workbook. She was so proud of the work she'd done. She was so excited to learn. She was desperate to learn. And she was in a family like so many of the others that we met who would support her education to the ends of the earth, but they just don't have the resources. Basic, essential resources aren't there. You might think that we only spoke to success stories, the perfectly framed examples of the ideal refugee. I don't personally think that's the case, even in the conversations that were pre-organized. But I will also add that as we walked around the camp, so many girls rushed up to us, so many people wanted to tell us what their lives were like, and we spoke to many of them. Typically, when they first came up to me, they said their name, they asked how I was, and they said thank you, and these were the phrases that they knew. My Arabic, terrible, comprises only of shukram, which means thank you. It's a tired cliche of Westerners visiting people in much, much more dire situations than they will ever know. Kids in pictures, kids getting excited about technology. But I want to say this, when we were walking around the high point of Zaatari camp at sunset, some kids asked for my camera, so I gave them this camera, in fact, and were taking pictures of each other with it. Seeing them do that, I couldn't help think of them as directors, as somehow in control of their story, as people in control of their lives and their futures. The truth is that there is an element of control wrested away from these girls and all girls when they do not have access to education. They need education, and we all need them to have education in order for all of us to advance. A lot of the time when I see comments about refugees online, I get angry, but I read a comment today that actually just broke my heart. It said, "So what if girls don't get to go to school?" Aside from the fact that in my mind, this displays a complete failure to see these girls as real as students in the UK, US, Australia, Germany, Sweden, France, Norway, Canada, etc., it also points to our failure to see this as a moment of great opportunity for the prosperity of everyone. There are countless reports on the connection between educating women and advancing a country, from everything to economics, to child mortality. 2.8 million children's lives could be saved if all women had access to secondary education. 2.8 million. All of them as real as the women and girls I mentioned today. Join me in signing the International Women's Day letter linked below, in supporting the UN Refugee Agency and its partners, and in pushing for greater standards and access to education for everyone, everywhere. I'll see you very soon. Bye.